we start with gas transport, okay? So we have come a long way from the physical aspects of ventilation in the first chapter to understanding how blood and gases physically interact in the second chapter, all the lung zones, all that P over Q business, okay? Now we are coming to the level of blood. Please remember this. This chapter describes exactly what happens between the alveolar air and blood itself, okay? So we'll be looking at the properties of gas exchange, what happens to the gases in the blood, and so on and so forth. These are the learning objectives. We will look at the respiratory membrane first, the factors affecting gas diffusion, something that you must have done in physics in your earlier classes. We'll look at the concept of partial pressure of gases in liquids, and at the end we'll look at perfusion versus diffusion limited gases. When it comes, you will understand what this is all about. Okay, so we know that there is a conducting zone in the lung and there is a respiratory zone. The conducting zone is only used to conduct air in bulk from the atmosphere to the inner areas where gas exchange is actually happening. That part is the respiratory zone, okay, or the whole thing. So we will now introduce a term called the respiratory unit. It's also called the respiratory lobule, and this is what it entails, okay? So a respiratory unit comprises of a respiratory bronchiole, which is right here, okay, alveolar duct, right here, and then the alveoli. What we are more concerned now is not the gross anatomy, but actually what is the membrane? What does the membrane consist of? Okay, the membrane across which a gas needs to travel. So you need to really zoom in at the level of the alveoli and alveolar vessel border or boundary. Okay, imagine that you are sitting in the alveolus and you have to travel out of it into the blood. So whatever layers you have to go through, those layers combined are referred to as respiratory membrane. This is an important question. So people get asked about the respiratory membrane, enumerate its layers, and then the second question, natural question, is what are the factors that affect gas exchange across this respiratory membrane? Okay, so first up is respiratory membrane. So it doesn't matter which way you start counting this from, but let's say you are in the alveolus. The first layer that you come across is the fluid and the surfactant mixed fluid layer, very thin fluid layer, which lines the inside of the alveoli. Then you have the alveolar epithelium right at the back, okay, which is supported by its basement membrane. It's just anatomy, really. It's histology, actually. And so this is the boundary of the alveoli. The fluid layer, the alveolar epithelium, and the basement membrane, which backs it up. And then you have a no man's land. This is the interstitial space. Please have a good look at it. So this is this whole thing, this whole gray right here, is the interstitial space between the alveolar membrane and the endothelium of the alveolar capillary. Okay, so remember, you are traveling from inside the alveolus outwards towards the blood capillary, the alveolar capillary. So when you move from this area towards this, like this, when you are in the interstitium, now the boundary of the capillary starts. So the first thing in the capillary is the basement membrane. So the outermost layer is the basement membrane, then is the capillary endothelium, and then that's, you're inside the vessel. So in alveolus you have three layers, in capillary you have two layers. And if you count in between the interstitium, it's not really a layer, but it's a space. Okay? Remember, when there is edema, pulmonary edema, and remember that it's a medical emergency, the fluid that accumulates is in the interstitial space. Okay? This should be clear. And you can imagine then that if there is, so this is a potential space, not really a space, but a potential space. I've explained that earlier. So this potential space should not normally be occupied by anything really. Now imagine putting water in it. So what are you doing? If you are putting water in the interstitial space, I'll explain it right here. You are increasing the effort. You are increasing the distance between the alveolus and the capillary. This distance nature has really compressed so that there is not much effort for the gas to go from alveolus into blood and reverse blood into alveolus. So this to and fro movement should be effortless, seamless, and it is like that. However, when problems arise like edema, you have increased the distance between these layers. Can you think of another condition which will mess up this situation? Pulmonary fibrosis. So there are lots of now fibrous tissue in between. That will also increase the distance. So think about those things. This is respiratory membrane done. Now, a bit of physics, very brief. So there are two types of movements in the lung, bulk flow and diffusion. Bulk flow is the air that you take in and it goes through the conduction zone. So the conduction zone movement of air is bulk flow. What happens in the respiratory zone is diffusion. So between alveoli and blood, that very vital thing that this whole system is made for, diffusion of gases or gas exchange, as you said. Only two laws for your knowledge here. Gaitin explains this in detail. Other books also go into a lot of details. However, it's not really necessary. A lot is not necessary at your level. So in Henry's law, it describes gas in a liquid. Why are we concerned with this gas in a liquid? Because blood. Eventually, when you hop a gas from alveolus into blood, blood is a liquid. So we need to understand how does that interaction, what governs that interaction? So when a gas is introduced in a liquid, what happens to it? Okay, and what are the factors affecting to it? So if an examiner would ask you a specific question, the forces or the principles which govern gas in a liquid phase, Henry's law is what he's referring to. And there are two points really: partial pressure of gas and solubility of gas, i.e. if you increase the difference, partial pressure is the difference between the source and the destination. If you increase this pressure, there will be more gas in the liquid as opposed to less pressure. If you exert less pressure of the gas, there will be less presence of this particular gas in liquid. If you increase the pressure, there will be more entry of this gas into this liquid, number one. Number two, solubility. So not all gases have the same solubility ability. Do you know between oxygen and carbon dioxide, which is more soluble?
Carbon dioxide.
Carbon dioxide is very soluble. So at any given partial pressure, carbon dioxide really wins as compared to oxygen for any given partial pressure. Of course, partial pressure in itself is a factor which affects gas transfer. Fick's law is operable more in this chapter because it deals with transfer of gases across a membrane. And in this case, that membrane is, we've just done it, the respiratory membrane. So the factors which affect diffusion of gases across the respiratory membrane are dealt by Fick's law. Once that transfer has occurred into blood, then you would say Henry's law has become operable. Okay. So in this, you have partial pressure again, diffusion quotient, membrane surface area, and thickness. These are the four things that affect gas transfer across a membrane. So the more partial pressure you exert, from the alveolus, and between the alveolus and the blood, the higher this gradient, the more transfer there will be. That's a very obvious point. Number two is diffusion. I've just described that if the gas itself has a higher solubility ability, then this quotient will be higher. So carbon dioxide is 20 times more soluble and 20 times more higher diffusion quotient than oxygen. Okay. Number two, surface area. If the membrane is of a normal healthy person, the entire respiratory membrane is available for gas exchange. However, if this person has emphysema or any other issue which affects the pulmonary fibrosis or edema, now you need to think about the membrane damage. If there's a damage to the membrane itself, there will be decrease in this overall surface area available for gas transfer. Okay, so in this case, that is also a very important point. And membrane thickness, I've just described that edema increases the thickness. Thickness is the only point here out of these four which has inverse proportion with gas transfer. So the more the thickness, the less the diffusion for obvious reasons. Okay. Right. This is the theoretical part of transport and gas exchange, gas transport, okay, from one place to another. Theoretical part. This is the practical one. This is one that is used, these are the terms that are used in the clinical setting. So DN, remember DL, okay? This is lung diffusion capacity. This is the term that is commonly used in actual clinical practice, okay? And it combines just about everything along with one very crucial thing, because now we are talking about a lung. Remember, Henry's law was not originally developed for the lung. It can be any gas in any liquid. So is Fick's law. Movement of gases across an experimental membrane is there. But we can apply it on the respiratory membrane. However, this concept is actually developed for the human lung or a lung. Okay. So diffusion quotient is there. Solubility bit, surface area is there, of course, membrane thickness. So it draws upon from Fick's law, of course. But this bit here makes it much more relevant to the lung situation, which is the time. The time that it requires, and I want your focus here, because the rest you know, this is something new. So the time it requires for certain gases to interact with certain elements of the blood, that also needs to be taken into account when you calculate diffusion capacity for a gas. What does this mean? Very simple. Oxygen is carried in blood in combination with hemoglobin. Hemoglobin is a protein with proteins in pulmonary capillary blood. So the time it takes for oxygen to get transferred across those layers is not enough. You need to also know that it will take a slightly more time for it to mix with blood first in the plasma, then start to combine with hemoglobin inside the RBCs. This also requires additional movement, additional time. That needs to be taken into account by DL, and it does. It cannot be measured in clinically. You cannot measure it via oxygen. It has to be measured via carbon monoxide. Okay? For those interested, can ask me this question later on. We actually use a very highly injurious gas, carbon monoxide. It's lethal at higher doses. But here, it is a single breath test. So I'm giving you enough keywords for you to look it up if you are interested. The actual DL baseline data is calculated using single breath carbon monoxide test. Okay. This is the stuff which can come in your assessment. In MCQs, Viva's, less SEQs really. It's more of a MCQ and Viva thing. How does DL differ or change from normal in emphysema? So you know now, by now you know that in emphysema there is destruction of the architecture of the lung. So in many a place, you'll actually have a breakdown of the respiratory membrane, thus affecting which element? Surface area of the lung. So there is less surface area available in patients of emphysema, okay? Hence affecting DL, okay? Now, pulmonary fibrosis, edema, pneumonia, we've already done. Increase in thickness, that also affects the DL. Anemia, what is anemia? You've done blood. Decrease in amount of RBCs or hemoglobin. Okay, so if there is less hemoglobin available in blood, then the time required, for the binding will raise, will increase, because hemoglobin is not readily available, it's less. And lastly, exercise. How can you increase DL in exercise? It increases, by the way.
Less.
That's constant. We are just exercising. Remember the recruitment, blood flow, recruitment thing that I have mentioned in alveoli? So with in exercise, you have those dormant capillaries and alveoli which you were not using at rest, they open up as well. So you net, you have increased amount of blood that comes in and increased amount of air that comes in. So both dormant alveoli, unused alveoli open up, recruitment, and those dormant capillaries which were alongside those dormant alveoli, both of them open. Okay, that results in more air coming in, more blood going through. DL really rises, okay, which you need, because you need extra oxygen. Okay, so this concept I have been surprised through my years here, that even doctors who have done their post graduation, sometimes they don't really understand a very basic concept, which I hence have labeled in red here at the bottom. But let's take it step by step. So gases are carried in liquid. They can be carried in a couple of ways. Okay, one is dissolved. So just physically dissolve the thing in a liquid. That's one way. Okay, oxygen gets dissolved in plasma all the time. It has to. Okay, the carbon dioxide as well. Number two, bound to proteins. So hemoglobin, oxygen is an example. Carbon dioxide, hemoglobin is also an example. Okay. Number three, chemical modification of the gas inside a liquid. So it enters as a gas, it gets modified chemically, gets carried by this liquid, and at the destination it reconstitutes to become a gas. How cool is that? An example?
CO2,
carbon dioxide. The most the bulk way of transporting carbon dioxide is actually chemical modification as
bicarbonate.
Well done. Bicarbonate. Okay? So This is the point here. The total gas concentration is, you need to add all the forms together. You get the actual total content of a gas in that liquid. So if you want to know how much your blood can carry, say, oxygen, you need to take into account all three forms of oxygen. Then you can say that, right, this is the amount of oxygen. Here, I will just hint at something else as well. There is a total capacity of carrying a gas. So, human blood can carry oxygen maximally to a known quantity. That's called the total ability or the total carriage. The total ability of the blood to maximally carry oxygen. That is a reference point. So you go for a blood test, for as an example. All your blood parameters, so you know what CBC is? So you have RBC count, hemoglobin percentage, etc., etc. And then you have normal values written across those values which they got from you. Okay, so that is reference values. So we have figured out that in a male or a female, the normal range of RBC is this. The normal range of hemoglobin is this, and so on and so forth. This is called reference range or normative data. So we know the maximum amount of oxygen that can possibly be carried by blood. With that reference, we compare individual actual carrying of oxygen in patients, in normal people, and so on and so forth. If it comes to that point, very well. If it's lesser than that reference, then there is a problem in oxygenation. Anything can go wrong. It can be a V over Q deficit. It can be a problem with the membrane itself. It can be a problem with the blood itself. or it can be just a problem because you're visiting Murray, high altitude, where the barometric pressure of everything is quite low. So partial pressure of oxygen in atmosphere is low. What are you going to do? Everything is fine, but the atmosphere oxygen content is low. Okay. Now comes to the red. Let's come to the red stuff. So this is where I will go slow. Imagine an alveolar capillary winding around the alveolus. Okay. It has just brought in deoxygenated blood. So at the entry point, it's now entering the capillary, and this is the alveolus, and here it is, your deoxygenated blood coming, seeping through. As it's exposed to a high oxygen air inside the alveolus, and you know that inside the alveolus, it is getting its fresh air from the atmosphere. So inside it's more, outside it's deoxygenated blood, so oxygen tension is less. What will happen? What will happen is the oxygen will instantaneously start to cross the respiratory membrane and arrive inside blood. We call this whole process oxygenation. Yes? But here you need to really slow it down. What happens exactly with this oxygen? I'm going to explain it to you slowly. First, this oxygen needs to dissolve in plasma. It does not combine with hemoglobin directly, as you may have imagined up to this point. The first step is dissolving it in plasma. So when you expose deoxygenated blood to any high oxygen source, what happens is oxygen starts to first dissolve in the liquid portion of blood, which is the plasma. It's here, mark my words now, it is here in the dissolved state in the plasma that the partial pressure of oxygen starts to rise. So once again, it's the dissolved part of a gas which exerts its partial pressure, not bound, not modified, dissolved. Yes? Once that partial pressure rises, that partial pressure is responsible for binding oxygen to hemoglobin. Not the incoming fresh oxygen which is getting dissolved. No. That basically ends up in plasma, gets dissolved, rises partial pressure of oxygen in the plasma. This increasing partial pressure then subsequently guides the oxygen that go and bind to hemoglobin. Do you understand this two-phase thing? And I have slowed it down. It happens instantaneously. Quicker than you can lid your, you can blink, okay? But exactly what happens is this. And it's very, very important to know this. Why? I'll tell you one situation, and hopefully you will never forget the importance of this concept. So you are working in the emergency, and somebody brings in a young man, half drowsy and confused and almost unconscious, in and out of consciousness. The people who brought him in, they say that he tried to commit suicide. Tried. Obviously not successful. You ask how? Well, they say he tried to inhale a lot of carbon monoxide. I won't tell you the usual way it's done, because obviously, hey, can't make it easy, can I? So, you go for arterial blood gases immediately. You take his blood, you send it to the lab, and you ask the lab to get me the blood gases in this chap. Okay? They come back normal for oxygen. So partial pressure of oxygen in this guy is normal. How is that possible? How is that possible? It is possible for those who understand this concept. So the concept is, jaldi se.
So carbon monoxide is zyada affinity rakhti hai hemoglobin ke sath bind karne ke liye, to already bind kar chuka
hai. Aapka bhi jawab hai? Right. So carbon monoxide, when it enters into blood, its ability to bind with hemoglobin is so high that it really beats oxygen at every level. Transport across the respiratory membrane, it beats oxygen. It has a very quick rate of, it has a very high solubility rate. So it really crosses very quickly. Partial pressure cannot really be measured of carbon monoxide because it just starts to soak up hemoglobin very instantaneously. Okay? And it doesn't disturb the partial pressure of oxygen because the oxygen keeps in its dissolved form. However, the competition is won at the level of hemoglobin. With hemoglobin, it displays and throws out oxygen molecules and binds to the hemoglobin itself. So in this person, very, very confusingly for the new ER resident, is the situation that partial pressure of oxygen has come out to be normal in a patient who clearly has hypoxic symptoms, symptoms of overall body hypoxia. Okay, and this is one of those off-throwing cases where you would have a normal PO2, but there will be raging hypoxia in this person because of carbon monoxide poisoning. Remember that one.